We rejoice because she was a child of the Most High God and absent from the body, present with the Lord. And so remember to pray for Sister Bent. Remember to pray for the family, that the Lord will strengthen them. Can we praise the Lord? Amen. Amen. Minister, you want to just pray in Jesus' name.
Let us bow our heads. Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for your awesome presence here this afternoon, Lord Jesus. We thank you, O God, for being with us, O God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, hallelujah, for showing up in our midst, Lord. And as we are about to hear your words today, O God, we pray for your awesome anointing. We pray, O God, that your words will go forth, Lord Jesus, and will break down some prison walls, will break down some depression, will break down those hearts that are discouraged right now, and strengthen them, O God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you have done. We thank you, O God, for what you are doing. And we thank you, Almighty God, for what is to come. Hallelujah. As we open up our hearts right now, we pray, Lord Jesus, that you bless our pastor right now, that you use him as an oracle of your word, Lord Jesus, that you'll open up his mouth, Lord Jesus, and send forth a sure word from the throne. We give you the glory, the honor and the praise, and we thank you again in Jesus' name. Praise.
Thank you. Genesis chapter number 50 and verse 20. But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good. Was that what you said, moderator? To bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good. God bless you. Oh, can we praise the Lord? Somebody praise him if he's a good God. Somebody praise him if he has been good to you. Somebody praise him if he took you through 2015 and caused you to stand right now and rejoice. Won't you praise him again? Anybody in the house, your feet? I hear Sister June said it wasn't that our feet was nice slipping, but in some cases it actually slipped. But then look around and tell somebody, thank God, we are all here. Thank God, we are all here. There is something about the Almighty that we cannot say it too much. We cannot overemphasize it. We cannot talk about it to the point where we become tired of talking about it. He is a good God. He is a great Savior. He knows how to take care of his own. There is something about the God that we serve. He looks out for his children in a way that we can never and will never comprehend. Many times we misunderstand him, and therefore we doubt him. But I hear the Lord saying to us this morning, don't ever doubt me. My love for you is too deep and too strong. My love for you is higher than the highest mountain. My love for you will go to the deepest part of the sea. It is deep and wide and high, so high that you can't get over it, so low that you can't get under it, so wide that you cannot get around it. The love of God. Oh, praise the Lord, somebody. If you believe God loves you, won't you praise the Lord? If you believe God cares for you, won't you praise the Lord? If you believe God is on your side, won't you praise the Lord? Do you believe He's always looking out for you? Always busy opening doors. Always busy making a way for you. Won't you praise the Lord? My God is a good God, and I love Him, and I encourage every saint in the house to love the Lord with all of your heart. Love Him with all of your might. Love Him with everything that you have got, because He's great. He's greatly to be praised, and He loves you with an everlasting love. Oh, can we praise the Lord? So Joseph said, he thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good. Did you know that when the Lord spoke to Moses and told Moses to go down to Pharaoh and demand of him to let my people go? Did you know that when he went down to Pharaoh and spoke to him and declared and demanded of Pharaoh, let my people go, saith the Lord, that they may go over yonder to worship and serve me? Did you know that the first thing that Pharaoh did was to turn around and speak to the men that were under him and told them to increase the pressure? Follow me closely. Increase the pressure, because these people need to understand that the words that Moses spoke to them, let them understand that those were waste words. He wanted them to doubt the words. He wanted them to think that those words will never stand. And so Pharaoh used a diabolical trick and said to his men beneath him, turn up the pressure, so that if they think that they are going to be delivered today, then if they were pressured here, turn it up to here. And from that time, even to this day, it is one of the diabolical tricks of the enemy, and Satan uses it to this day. If God has a word for you and tell you today that you are going to be delivered, as I am telling you today, Satan meant it for evil, the things that you were going through in 2016. But can I declare to you this morning, God is going to use every evil that came up against you, and He's going to turn it and fix it and set it, and it is going to redound to the good of the people of Almighty God I speak that into being right now. But as I speak it right now, just as how Satan worked through Pharaoh and told Pharaoh to command his men to turn up the pressure just before your deliverance comes. Oh, hallelujah. The pressure is going to be turned up. 2015 has passed, and we are now in 2016. Anybody looking for victory in 2016, put up your hands. Looking for victory in 2016, give a shout of praise to Almighty God. You feel that this is your year of jubilee. You feel that this is your time of deliverance. Won't you praise the Lord? But hear me right now. I believe victory is on the way. I believe victory is here. I believe victory is at your door. I believe the job that you were praying for is here right now. Anybody here not working? Let me see your hand. Your deliverance is here. I speak that with every ounce of faith. Your deliverance is here. I feel it. I feel it. I feel it. Brother Carlton said earlier on that Satan did a lot of things and he reduced the money in some people's bank accounts. But he's a blessed man, because he has a bank account with money that can come down. But some people don't even have the account with money, much less for it to come down. Anybody here broke this morning? Put up your hand. God Almighty is going to open doors that we are going to be unable to receive what he's going to be doing. And I speak that with every ounce of faith. Hallelujah. It's the year of jubilee. It's a time of abundance for many. Hallelujah. You have been going through a lean time for a long time. And I didn't come to say this, but I feel like saying it. I believe the time has come for many. Hallelujah. Because you have been faithful in little. You have sacrificed even in your nothingness. God is going to open the windows of heaven. And the blessings of Deuteronomy 28. I pronounce upon this congregation. The blessings in the book I pronounce on this house. The blessings that are written that belongs to the people of God, I pronounce it upon you. Blessed shall thou be in the city. Hallelujah. Blessed shall thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body. Hallelujah. And the fruit of thy ground. And I speak this with all faith. The fruit of thy cattle. The increase of thy kind. The flock of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store. Blessed shall thou be when thou comest in. and blessed shall thou be. Hallelujah. When you go out, my sister said this morning that many traps were set for her. And I know that many traps were set for people, the people of God in the house. Traps were set for me. But God flew every trap. Hallelujah. Some of them you didn't even know. Some of them you didn't even recognize were there. You didn't know when you went in that night. And when you opened the door, the gate before you reached the door, you didn't know who was standing in the corners because of a wrong report and a bad report that somebody gave about you. You didn't know. But God caused them to hear a sound. Hallelujah. And they got up and left because God was preparing the way, because he has blessed you, because you're a child of the Most High God. And I say, and I speak it this morning, blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in. God of heaven, send his angel and protect your territory. Blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. When you open the door in the morning, God of heaven, be a shield, hallelujah, around the people of God. The God shall cause thine enemies that rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way, running to your doors, running to your place of work, running to your place of business one way. God knows that the devil hates you. He knows that the devil hates where you work because you are there. He knows that the devil wants to tear down your business because you are there. And so he sends demonic forces one way to bring you down. But the blessings of Almighty God go before you. I speak the blessings of God on this house. I speak the blessings of Deuteronomy 28 on this house. The devil shall come before you one way, but when he buck up into Almighty God, the angel of the Lord stand before you. The angels of the Lord go before the people of God. And when the enemy come in one way, he shall flee seven ways. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I pronounce a blessing on the choir. Satan desire to sift you like wheat. Satan cause your husbands to turn against you. Satan cause your wives to turn against you. Satan cause things to happen to cause division and contention and strife. But he comes in one way to bring destruction. Hallelujah. I speak the word of faith. I speak and pronounce the blessings of the Lord upon this choir. Devil, flee in Jesus' name. Go in Jesus' name and leave the people of God. Leave the choristers. Lead the leaders. Let Judah go first. Let those that have the praise in their lips, let them go first. We come against you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Leave, leave, leave the people of Almighty God. But understand, saints, that he is not going to get up and run. Understand what is going to happen. Your deliverance is here right now. I believe the jobs are here. I believe the healing is here. I believe the business is about to burst. I believe things are about to happen. Salvation is about to burst in the lives of many that are here. But here is what Satan is going to do. He's going to allow it so that when you go home this evening, your neighbors will start curse you. Don't be surprised if when you go this evening, your neighbors start to curse you. Don't be surprised if when you go this evening, there is a rift with you and your husband, or you and your wife are putting you on guard, because we're going to come against the devil and we're going to trample him. Don't be surprised if when you go this evening, or you go to, for those who work, when you go tomorrow, your boss say, I can't deal with you again. Don't be surprised if you get a demotion shortly. Don't be surprised if you lose the job shortly. Don't be surprised if your husband pack up and say, I am walking out. Follow me now. Because it not going to happen, but follow me. Don't be surprised. If you hear as you go in that there is a letter for you, because this is how Satan works. When the word came, let my people go, Pharaoh said, turn up the pressure. You feel pressured now? Anybody in the house feel pressured? Be honest with me. You feel pressured at work? You feel like you're under the economic pressure? But you feel that your deliverance is going to come? Here, what's going to happen? It's going to get worse. It's going to get worse. You're going to get up tomorrow and go and do the interview. Some folks have interviews set up, and you feel that this is your job and this is your time. But as I speak the word right now to let you know that your deliverance is here, believe it. Believe it. I say believe it. For your deliverance is in the house. Many folks are going to leave this morning with your faith up here and going to claim the things that are for you. What is for me is for me. What is for you is for you. And no devil in hell can stop it. But the devil in hell is going to press on you, because he's going to try to discourage you and cause you to doubt God. So he's going to turn it up hotter. He's going to turn it up and make the pressure come down heavy on your head. But I was told just a few moments ago to tell you, when the pressure turn up, lift up your heads to the hills, your eyes to the hills, from whence cometh your help. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Be lifted up, ye everlasting doors. Allow the King of Glory. Allow the King of Glory to come in for you. The devil is going to try to tell you that you're going to lose and you're going under and that you're not going to make it. But I'm here to tell you, you're going to make it in Jesus' name. You're coming through in Jesus' name. The job is yours in Jesus' name. The business will prosper in Jesus' name. I feel victory in the house. I feel deliverance. But I know that the pressure is going to be turned up. So when it turn up, saints of the Most High God, don't say, oh my God, look, it's me again. It's happening to me again. Don't say that. When the pressure turn up now, hear what you say. I will lift up mine eyes. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Can I tell you what to say? My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. Can I tell you what to say? The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Can I tell you what to do? Oh, magnify the Lord. Let us exalt his name together. When they turn up the heat, praise God. When they turn up the pressure, praise God. When they turn up everything and everything is going haywire, praise God. Because before the deliverance come, the pressure gonna turn up. And then when Moses did not yield, and he went back and said, Pharaoh, thus said the Lord, let my people go. When they didn't budge under the pressure, Pharaoh realized that they were determined, in spite of the pressure, to walk into deliverance. Pharaoh then turned to Moses and said, okay, you may go, but serve God in this land. Don't go over yonder wilderness. Stay right here. Follow me. So he tries to give you a little release, but he says, stay in Egypt. He's disorienting them now. I'm saying, you're getting your freedom, but stay in Egypt. Some folks don't leave out of the environment of sin. Some folks are saying hallelujah in church on Sunday, but on Monday, they are saying something else. Some folks are in suit on Monday and Sunday, but they are in their dancing shoes on wet Wednesday. They are there. They are there on fancy Monday. They are there on dirty Friday. They are there. They are there. So that the very thing that Satan allowed to happen, when Moses said, let my people go, and Pharaoh said, go, but don't go out of the environs of Egypt. There are some saints or some people that have somehow received this thing, but they have one foot in church and one foot in the world. Hallelujah. Come out of the world. Come into this thing. Walk with God. Follow. So then Moses said, let my people go. We're not staying in Egypt. Follow what Moses now said. Let us go according to the word of the Lord. And Pharaoh now looked around and said, all right, you can go over into the wilderness and serve your God, but don't go too far. You following? So go, leave Egypt, go into the wilderness to serve your God, but don't go too far. So he wants you to still have a taste. Your mind still in Egypt. He's talking about compromising. Go over wilderness to worship, but don't go too far. Still remember the things of Egypt. That's compromise. And Satan wants you to compromise your relationship with Almighty God, so that when he has you there, have you there, he have you in the palm of his hands. And when you are compromised in your walk with God, then you lose your vision. Oh, hallelujah. Follow me. You lose your vision. You don't have no appetite for the things of God. Watch it. Watch it. Because if the deliverance is going to come, you can't be in Egypt. If the deliverance is going to come, you can't be out of Egypt but still near to Egypt. You have to go far away and worship God and allow him to pour out the blessings upon you. So I spoke just now and pronounced a blessing upon this house. But the blessing is not for those who have one foot in and one foot out. The blessing is not for those who have left Egypt, but you're still near. Come on now. It will not come upon you. So here, lastly, hear what Pharaoh did. Moses went over, said, this time, listen. Hear the word of the Lord. Let my people go, that they may go and serve and worship the living God. Pharaoh said, go. Go away into the wilderness. Carry your young ones with you. But leave your cattle. Leave your herd. He wanted them to leave back something in Egypt. Because he knew that where their treasure was, hallelujah, their heart was going to be there. And it didn't matter how far they went. Once they left back something of value, they're going to look back like Lot's wife. So Pharaoh said, leave the cattle and the herd. But I hear Moses said, no, 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 no. If we're going to serve God, we're going to serve him with all our heart. We're going to serve him with all our might. We're going to serve him with all our mind. And we're not going to leave a hoof behind. And I feel that that must be the mindset of the people of God in the house this morning. We are leaving to serve God. Let us serve him in 2016. This is the year to go to God with a made up mind. Don't be tricked by the enemy to believe that you can be in church today and in the world tomorrow. It does not work. You're going to lose out. Some people are missing their blessings, not because God don't want to pour it out right now, but because you are in Egypt still, near Egypt still. Leave back your cattle in Egypt still. But I'm here to tell the saints of the Most High God, leave Babylon and come. Don't look for me down in Egypt, son. Oh, let that be your song this morning. For I have pitched my tent way up in Beulah land. Anybody in the house feel like you want to give God full 100 in 2016? Praise the Lord. Let your voice be heard. Let the devil know that you missed some steps last year. But this is going to be a different year. This is going to be 100 for Almighty God. Not a hoof is going to be left behind. No, 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 no. If it's time to serve God, I'm going to serve God. When it's time to pray, I'm going to pray. When it's time to worship, I will worship. And that's all the time. Oh, can we praise the Lord? Can we praise the Lord? But having said that, we look at Joseph, who made the statement that we read from Genesis chapter 50. But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it, or he turned it for good. Joseph did nothing wrong. Joseph served the Lord with his whole heart. Joseph depended heavily on Almighty God. Joseph, from his youth, had his visions and revelations. He knew what it was to pray. He knew what it was to have dreams and had God interpreting those dreams to him and for him. He knew. He knew what it was to walk with God. He knew what it was to commune with and to talk with God. He had a strong relationship with Almighty God, to the point where people were jealous. His brothers were jealous and decided that they had to do something against him because his father loved him above all the other boys and girl. And out of a heart that was set on God, his brothers took him and threw him into a pit because of jealousy. Here was a man that did nothing wrong, but he was thrown in a pit. Here was a man that did nothing wrong. And some folks were passing and saw him and took him away. And then he was sold into slavery. A man that loved God, a man that walked with God, was now thrown into a pit, and then from the pit, taken and sold into slavery, and he served God. The question is, what kind of God is this? And some folks will turn a finger and say, look at your God. My God would never do something like that. My God would take care of his own. My God would never make one of his greatest adherents suffer like that. But that's what they say. And their gods are not even real gods. So just imagine the God that we serve, how much more he would take care of his own. But when you fall into a pit, it doesn't mean that God doesn't love you. You might be surprised to know that God allowed it to happen, because it couldn't happen unless God allowed it. The evil would not have originated with God. But when God saw that you were thrown into the pit, he has a way to take your situation and turn it around in the right time so that it comes out for your good. So that if the devil or the enemy throws a net at you, it won't always miss you. Come on now. It will catch you sometime. But when it catches you, it doesn't mean that God is not on your side. It simply means that God is doing something that is going to redound to your good. But he wants to teach us something. He wants to teach us patience. He wants to teach us to learn to trust him. He wants to teach us to learn to depend on him. Because some of us believe that we trust God, but under certain circumstances, we find out that we really don't trust him. Or can we praise the Lord? Some of us say, I will die for him. But when the men with the guillotine come, they run and they hide. Remember Peter, that's how we are. And we'll say all manner of things. I will die for you. I will never doubt you. Until the situation confronts you and you run away and leave God. But I hear the Lord speaking clearly. I will never leave you or forsake you. And so here it was, Joseph in the pit, sold into slavery, and then went into Egypt. And in Egypt, we know the story well. For nothing wrong that he did, he was thrown into prison. So first a pit, then a slave, then thrown into prison, and left there. And you know what Joseph did? He continued to worship God. He continued to call upon his God. He continued to commune with Almighty God. How many of us would do that? I have seen people backslid because they thought that God had forgotten them. I have seen people leaving church because they did not get a car when all their contemporaries got one. I know of men and women that have left the house of God because of things that they did not get. But here was a man that was thrown in a pit, sold as a slave, then thrown into prison, and was there not for a week, not for a month, not for a year, but for many years. 2 years after the buckler came out, but we don't know how many years before that. So it was a rough journey for Joseph. It was a rough journey, and it caused people to question the love of God. It caused people to wonder if God is really with those that call upon him. But I am here to declare this morning that whatever your 2015 was, however low you might have gotten, however bad the situation was, it does not matter. When the situation pressed you down, the love of God did not go down. I want somebody to understand that the love of God for you will never diminish.
It is rich and strong as it has always been. But God has a way of working and doing his thing to bring about his glory first and the good of his people. If you find yourself in that pit, don't curse God. If you find yourself in the prison, don't curse God. If you find yourself carried into captivity, into slavery, don't curse God. The same energy that it takes to curse is the same energy it takes to give a praise. And there is something about giving a praise. When we praise God, he tends to move. He's a God that is moved by praise and worship. When he hears worship coming up, many times God does his thing in his time, and you can't move him from his time. But there is something that can move God. When God hears prayer, when God hears praise, when God sees the incense of our worship coming up, there is something about God. He's drawn to worship. If you want God to come around you, if you want God to dwell around you, it's time to worship him. It's time to lift him up. It's time to glorify him. What is the bad thing that is happening in your life right now? Can you picture it in your mind? What is the thing that have you in bondage right now? Can you see it? Picture it right now, saint of God. The thing that causes you to be down. The thing that causes you to be out. The things that causes you to stumble. What is it? Think about it right now. As you think about it, lift your heart. Lift your hands. Lift your voice. Hallelujah. We're going to break it right now. We're just going to invite the presence of God into your situation right now. What is it that is breaking you down? What is it that is tearing you down? What is it that is having you moving away from Almighty God? What is it that is your greatest pressure? What is it that is your greatest problem? What is it? Do you have it in your mind? Can you think of it? Are you thinking of it? Answer. Just shake your head. That thing that is holding you down, can you picture it there? Lift your hands right now. As you have that thing in mind, lift your hands and start worshiping God, praising him, because God is going to hear that prayer. God is going to feel, if it is, let it come from deep within. It could be a relational issue. Your husband is giving you the warmest time. Your wife has decided that she can go no further. And it is the most difficult thing for you. You feel that you're going mad. You feel that your head is going. You feel that you're going to crack under the pressure. And you just don't know what to do. You have come to pastor. Pastor, help, help, help. But you know there are some things that pastor cannot do. There are some things that deacons cannot do. There are some things that only God Almighty can do. And I feel right now that there are some folks in the house that ought to put their situation in front of your eyes now. And as it is there before you, lift those hands in truth. Start to call on God. When he hears heartfelt praise and worship, he has a tendency to move. He has a tendency to say, what is that over there? He has a tendency to cause it to be transformed into sweet smelling incense that comes before his nostril. And when it comes before his nostril and is a sweet smell, God moves and come down from to the source of that praise. If that praise is coming from you, sister, if that praise is coming from you, sister, if that praise is going up to him from you, brother, he's going to come down to you, the source. And when God comes into your situation, it must turn around immediately. I say to you, it will turn around. And I'm not talking about 10 years from now. God has a way to do his thing in time. So for some people, it takes 10 years. For some people, it takes 20. And you know, God has a way of doing something right now. He's a right now God sometimes, you know. He's a God that just moves right now. He might pass and might take a while for some things. But send up the praise. Send up the worship. Lift your voice to him and you might be surprised to know that he moves right now. Can we praise the Lord? Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. And I feel God in the house that he wants to do something right now. It was meant for your evil, the thing that you were going through. It was meant to pull you down and to destroy you. But I'm here to tell you this morning, God is going to turn it around and he's going to use it for your good. I hear, I see where Haman built a gallows. God Almighty. And Mordecai was so troubled, a son of Almighty God. He was so troubled because they were going to hang him. Hallelujah. They were going to hang him. They were going to put him up with a gallows around his neck. For what? For nothing. For serving God. For being a Jew. But he knew how to pray. So he took off his pretty clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes. He put on sackcloth and ashes and said, God of heaven, remember me. Remember us. And he cried out to God. I said to us, God knows how to gravitate and come to the source of the worship. He knows how to come down. And when, remember now, you know, God does things in his own time. And his time can be any time, which is the right time. But he also has a way that him turn up quick before you say, who that is there in the situation? You don't know what God will do when. So what is important is that we call upon him every time. That we worship him every time. In the good times, praise his name. In the bad times, do the same. In everything, give the King of Kings all the praise. All the praise. All the praise. And Haman built the thing and had it there and decided that Mordecai is going to die because he would not bow down before Haman, though he was a son of God. Haman had no regard for him. Haman had no respect for him. And that is the way it is with the people of God. The people of this world don't even respect your faith. They don't respect the fact that you call upon God. But that's all right. You just serve God with all of your heart. You just serve God with everything that you've got. And when Mordecai started to pray, and he got some people to pray, and he got Esther to get together with him to pray. And when the prayer and the praise went up, God sniffed and smelled and said, I smell a sweet aroma, a sweet praise coming up into heaven. And God saw that it was coming from where Mordecai was. And God said, let me go down there and see what is happening. And when God saw the situation of those that he loved, hallelujah. When God saw it, God placed the king to sleep. I said, God, him know to get involved in human affair. You see, the Most High rules in the kingdom of men. The last time we talk about it, him drop a dream in Pharaoh. And Pharaoh dreamed something what him couldn't remember. And him sent Joseph at the right time to interpret the dream. This time, King, was it Artaxerxes, went to sleep. And him wake up, couldn't sleep, for something tell him to get up and go search the book of remembrance. And King Artaxerxes said, what kind of thing is this? Midnight, me get up and go search book. Lord, I can't sleep, so might as well I read the book. And when he was reading the book, all of a sudden, he saw in the Chronicles that there was a man named Mordecai that at sea of his life, God waited for the right moment. He could have done it a week before. He could have done it 2 months later. But he heard the praise of Mordecai coming up to him. When God hear heartfelt praise and worship in the midst of your trouble, he is going to cause a deep sleep to fall on your enemy. He's going to cause them to dream a dream. He's going to cause them to go through something, you not knowing that he's working it out for your good. Mordecai was only praying and worshiping and said, God help us. But he didn't even know that God wake up the king at midnight. And the king said, but Mordecai, who this? And he read how Mordecai stopped 2 men from assassinating him. So the king jumped up and said, oh my God. And he called for all his advisors and said, who is Mordecai? Them say, he's a man that is on the outside, your highness. They say, you remember this man that did this thing to save my life? They say, yes, O king. He did it. What was done for him? They said, nothing wasn't done, O king. And O king said, bring him come. Same time, 12 o'clock in the night, early morning, God have a way. It don't matter if it's 1 o'clock. Him going to wake up your enemy and turn it around. They might have meant it for your evil, but he is going to turn it around for good. And while they went to fetch Mordecai, he sent for Haman too. Lord have mercy. Me tell you, don't play with God. And don't play with God's people. Don't play. We are a chosen generation. A royal priesthood. A holy nation. A peculiar people. That we should show forth the praises of him. Call us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Send for Haman. And the king stood in front of Haman and said, tell me now, what must we do with a man in whom I find joy, in whom I find favor? How must I reward such a man? The wicked Haman think it was him. You see how the wicked people stay? Them know them killing people. Him set up gallows for the man. And when good things must come, them want it. Wicked. You're not going to get it. Not as long as God is God in heaven. The wicked go and go down. And the righteous shall be elevated. And that's why I declare and encourage the people of God. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. He's looking out for you. And when he asks Haman, what must I do to the man that in whom I find favor? Naaman thinking is him, say, get the royal robe. Hallelujah. You see the wealth of the wicked? It's for me. It's not that I want it. It's just that God have a way to take it and give it to us. Israel, when you're going out of Egypt, spoil them. Take them gold. Take the pot, take the silver, take the jewel. Walk out of Egypt with everything that you can carry. It belongs to you. Oh, can we praise the Lord? Hey, man, what I must do with such a man? Haman said, get the royal robe. Give him the royal ass to sit upon. Hallelujah. And I think he might ask for a ring or something. But he asked for the best of the best. And when the king said, oh, that sounds good, hear what you do. Call Mordecai. Hallelujah to God. Put it on him. Put on the ring on his finger. Put on the royal robe. And put him on the king's second horse. And walk in front of him and guide him. Here, man. Hold the rope and walk with Mordecai, the servant of the Most High God. We shall not go under, but we will go over. It was meant for evil, but God knows how to turn it around. God knows how to flip it around. and turn it for our good. Somebody praise the Lord. Somebody praise the Lord. Somebody praise the Lord. Keep praising Him. Keep worshiping Him. Keep lifting Him on high. He knows how. And Mordecai walked through the city as royalty. He was not even a Persian. He was a Jew. But the king didn't look at that. The king had to obey the commands of the Lord. When God said, I bless you, no man can curse you. Oh, can we praise the Lord? One night, an infortune was turned around. One night. God moved quick sometime. So just worship Him and live right. God can move at a split of a second. It was months that Samaria was besieged by King Ben-Hadad of Syria. Him locked down the city, tight like sardine, till an ass's head was sold for 80 pieces of silver. Till bird dung was being sold for about 8 pieces of silver. Bird doo-doo. Them say it high in protein. And them sell it for 8 pieces of silver. That is how bad the famine was. Because Ben-Hadad and the armies of Israel locked down Samaria for weeks and months. But then Elisha was praying. Elisha was worshiping God. Elisha and some people, I am sure, that knew God, the elders of Israel, was crying out to God. And God dropped a word in the heart of Elisha and said, tell the people that tomorrow, forget that you have been going through this for months. Forget that you're going through this thing for months. Forget that you're going through this thing for weeks. Forget that it's famine on the land. Tomorrow, this time. Tomorrow, this time. Flour going to be selling for the right price. And it's going to be in abundance. One man said, not even if God can open windows in heaven. You saw the man told my God, not even if God can open windows in heaven could this thing be. But my God just leaned up and says, warm to him. Where him come from? Him don't know me. Him don't know who I am. I am the Lord that made the heavens and the earth. Him don't know my credentials. God spoke to the heart of 4 leprous men. He never used an army. He used 4 lepers. I'm telling you how God take things and turn it around and use some odd situations to fix it for you. Don't doubt God. Don't be frustrated with God. Don't lose your faith in Him. Don't lose your confidence in Him. And 4 lepers got up. Them say, if we stay here, we're going dead. We're going to die. If we go over to the camp of the Syrian, I'm going to kill us the same way. But make we dead trying. You see the spirit of some lepers and some saints wouldn't say let me die praying. But I feel to encourage somebody, even if you die, die praying, die worshiping, die magnifying the living God. Hallelujah. And when those 4 lepers got up and started to walk to the camp of the Syrian, saints of the Most High God, God, turn up the volume on them feet. You know, when four men walking is a small sound. But you know, when 400,000 men doing the same thing is a loud sound. The Bible said that God caused the sounding of their feet, four men, to be like a mighty army going down to the Syrian camp. And the Syrians said in themselves, it looked like they got the kings of Egypt and other nations to join up with them. Not even the army of Syria, of Israel, you know, four leper. And God can use four leper to bring about your salvation. And when those lepers walked down to the camp of the Syrian, saints of God, the camp empty. Because when they heard the sound, the king run left him men. Hallelujah. God make king tremble. God make mighty men fear. And every one of them ran out of the camp. You can imagine the army of Syria run gone. Why? Because God knows how to take what was meant for your evil and demise and turn it around for your good. Hallelujah. They didn't know that he was working there. They didn't know that there was an unseen hand. While they couldn't see it, it was there working. It worked in Samaria. And the following day, they had food that they didn't have for months. It worked for Mordecai. And Joseph looked around and said, this is exactly what is happening. God is used, or had used my situation to bring her up about not only my good, but if I did not come to Egypt when the famine came, which was going to come, Jacob and his family would have died and there would have been no Israel. And therefore, there would have been no Messiah. And therefore, there would have been no salvation. I said, God, look down the line. When God doing something for you, and I'm looking down the line. You were looking about tomorrow, but God looking down the line.